and welcome to a new episode of our weekly program In the Hot Seat. And today we're going to be delighted to have joining us a very special guest who's going to be giving us more of an outlook towards where the Egyptian relation stands in front of the African nations and what are the challenges that the African continent is facing and means of boosting for a better development between Egypt and the African countries. And we're very much delighted to have joining us this evening Ambassador Mohammed Idris, Assistant Foreign Minister for African Affairs. Thank you very much for joining us on our weekly program In the Hot Seat. We're very much delighted to have you with us.
Thank you very much. It's my great pleasure and great honor.
There are a lot of things that we need to talk about and focus on when it comes to the African affairs. Let's start off by speaking about how do you evaluate the current Egyptian-African relations in general?
First, let me thank you very much because really it's very important to raise the awareness about the importance of the relation of Egypt with Africa. And media, of course, has a very important role in this, and this role is very highly appreciated. Of course, the relation between Egypt and Africa is multifaceted relation and multidimensional one, and that is how we should look at it. Sometimes we tend to summarize or abstract the relation into only one file relation. And this is not the proper perspective, and it's not the way which we serve our national interests. We have, of course, with Africa, multi-dimensional tracks. We have political relations, we have economic relations, we have investment, we have trade, we have cultural relations, we have so many aspects of cooperation, and we should pursue it in all fields. And this is really what we are trying to do. We are trying to tackle and to deal with this relation from its different aspects and in its entirety.
Mm-hmm. Now, as you said, there's a lot of files that should be focused on when it comes to the Egyptian-African relations. And then I want to ask you also, the fact that the African continent has a lot of rich resources but are not, you know, being used properly or they're being misused, why do you think that it's very difficult to sort of shed light on the very beautiful things in Africa that could be reflected to the rest of the world, whether it's in tourism, in exports and so forth? I mean, why do we speak of Africa, and when anyone speaks of Africa, there's this, they categorize it into one, you know, category, poverty, unemployment, and the list goes on. You know, from your field of expertise, why do you think this is the problem?
This is a short sight on our part, and then we have to confess that we are not dealing with Africa in the proper manner and from the proper perspective. And we have to do an extra effort to go out of the stereotypes and to rectify this a misleading perspective. We have to take in consideration that now with Africa, there are lots of partnerships between Africa and lots of the countries and lots of regional and international powers in the world, which reflects that there is cognizance about the wealth of this continent, about the vast opportunities available in this continent, and it is a must, it's due and obligation that we should be the ones who are more aware and more forthcoming in dealing with the continent from this perspective. Lots of opportunities in the African continent and lots of strategic and vital interests of Egypt with its African family. Mm-hmm. So this leads us to do an extra effort, both on the part of awareness and on the part of action on the ground and cooperation in different fields with our sisterly African countries.
Yeah, I'm glad you mentioned the role of the foreign ministry, and we must also, in this regard, speak of the many challenges that was faced in terms of Egypt's foreign policy that the foreign ministry is achieving on in all terms. That's why I want to ask you from here, What form of cooperation does the Egyptian Foreign Ministry do with other ministries, foreign relations in African countries to sort of reduce that gap of miscommunication, misinterpretation, different points of views regarding various files? How does this gap become reduced over time? I'm speaking here about the efforts that the Egyptian Foreign Ministry is doing.
Thank you very much. This is a very important point. And let me here highlight that foreign policy cannot be delinked from what happens at home. It's a reflection of what happens at home. And to have an effective, robust, active foreign policy, it's so much the summation and the outcome of also the situation at home, economically, politically, socially, and in all fields. And of course, to pursue an active foreign policy, it's not only the job of one entity or one organization or one ministry. The foreign ministry alone or an embassy alone cannot do this. It is a collective effort on the part of different agencies and ministries and authorities within the country. If we talk about our relation with territorial African countries in trade, in investment, in agriculture, in culture, whatever field, so that means that we need to have this synergy and complementarity in the relation between the foreign ministry and also many other agencies and ministries who work on the field in order to really implement these policies and not only to keep it as a rhetoric. Because there is a very important aspect here is to have a real action on the ground and not only to suffice with rhetoric. So the foreign ministry really are trying to activate and enhance this coordinating mechanism with the different agencies and authorities in the country. So we do have regular meetings to coordinate, to exchange views, to agree on the way forward, who will do what, when, what is the best way to do it. So it is a collective endeavor and a work in a synergy and in complementarity.
I'm glad you mentioned the meetings that the foreign ministry is, in this regard, is cautious in keeping up with. And then that brings to my mind the question of, from your years of experience, what has changed in terms of how the rest of the African countries view Egypt? During the past 30 years, Egypt has had this position towards in certain African countries that was not the best way of dealing with our neighbors. Yet that has changed after the 25th of January revolution, changed again after the 30s of June, and then we could say we're back again on track. I'm not just speaking about Egypt's membership in international communities, conferences and so forth, if we're talking about the African Union or the CMES or so forth, not just in terms of membership, but actually in terms of having an active role. How do you see how the African nations view Egypt today?
This is very important, of course, to mention that there is now rising cognizance, both at the official level and at the popular level as well, about the importance of our relations with our African family. This is very important because the starting point is to have the awareness and to have the motivation and to have the will. This is there, so we are moving on the right track. But of course, this alone is not enough. It needs to be activated and implemented on the ground. Of course, one have to say that the creating a new mentality is very important. At the popular level, we have to view Africa through the proper perspective. We have to view Africa through the multidimensional relations which we have with the vital interest which we have with our African continent. Of course, lots of changes have taken place on the African continent. Africa today is not Africa before. New challenges came. It's a wholly new political terrain on the ground. It's new challenges are emerging, new issues to be deal with, to deal with, new problems to tackle, and new aspirations, and the new capabilities are also evolving. And at the same time, there is, to a great extent, a new dynamics in the continent, and we have to cope with it. Of course, at some point, the main challenges the main challenge facing the continent was to achieve political liberation and independence, and at the time of decolonization. And Egypt stood fast and supported its African sisters in order to achieve this liberation and to gain independence. Mm-hmm. But of course, now we are in a different historical era, where the main challenge and the main hurdles are pertaining to achieving development, whether it's economic development, it's political or social development. So we have also to have evolution in our role and in our perspective and in our policies in order to deal with Africa of today, not Africa before.
Yes.
And also to have our role, not only, but usually we talk about historical role, we have to talk about our future role in the continent, not only to stop at our historical role, but to have inspiration of this role to move forward within new realities, with the new dynamics, in order to have an effective future role in shaping the future of this continent.
Yes, as you've correctly said, there are a lot of issues and problems that they might have deferred over the years. Yet, if we look at the African continent, you know, there are still many countries in Africa that are suffering from poverty, unemployment, illness, disease, lack of awareness, and the role of women, and the list that goes on. That's why it's for the role of a union, a very big union that is also internationally recognized, like the African Union, in which all the African countries stand together to try to face these challenges. And that's why I want to speak with you a little bit about Egypt's role in the African Union. Last year, their agenda was empowering women towards 2030 agenda, if I believe, and there were a lot of recommendations towards how they can achieve this goal by 2030. What can Egypt do in order to step in here and try to come up with resolutions that would be not only accepted and respected by the African countries, but actually taken into serious considerations?
Of course, our interaction with our sister African countries go through more than one track. One track is the bilateral relations, and in this we are trying, as I mentioned, to cope with the developments and also develop our tools in interaction with the African countries. For example, we have, of course, now the Egyptian Agency for the Partnership for Development, which is a tool for cooperation in the developmental field with sister African countries and producing and assistance in the field of capacity building and institution building. And also the Cairo Center for Peace Keeping and Peace Building, which is also providing lots of support, training, capacity building in the field of peace and security. Then we come to what you refer to, the relation in the multilateral fora. One of it, of course, is the African Union. Another is the United Nations. And now Egypt is a member of the Security Council, the National Security Council, and also Egypt now is running for membership of the African Peace and Security Council. But when you talk about peace and security, there is now an evolving view on how to deal with peace and security in the continent. That peace and security is not delinked from development. And there is a very important nexus between peace and security issues and developmental issues. And under this umbrella goes so many wide range and broad spectrum of issues about economic development, about programs for social development. And as you mentioned, last year was the African Year of Women. This year is the upcoming African Summit is going to declare this year to be the African Year for Human Rights, with special focus on rights of women. Now, the work with the African Union has multiplied a lot, and the agenda has become so wide, involving and encompassing the trade and industry, the economic issues, the political issues, peace and security issues, social issues, and under it, so many issues pertaining to women, youth, and gender issues, agriculture, environmental issues. So now the current structure and the current work in the African Union, which of course superseded the Organization of African Unity, before the agenda was so limited and the issues were and the challenges were focused on certain dimensions. But now this agenda became so wide And in all these issues, of course, Egypt is well positioned to provide so much significant contribution by virtue of the capacities which we have, the expertise and knowledge which we have, the experience which we went through on different aspects, the institutions which we have, technical institutions and political institutions, universities, research centers. So we do have lots of input which we can and we should produce in all these activities within the African Union. And this pulls into what we can name the African common position, because these issues also comes up to another international level on the international arena within the United Nations. And within that wider forum, Africa stands as one voice, and they have common African position representing the African countries. And of course, the role of Egypt in shaping this common African position is very important. Mm-hmm. And of course, when it comes to the wider arena, there are lots of actors and lots of different dynamics about the different interests at the global level. And the role of Egypt in defending Africa's interests and the African causes and the African aspirations and ambitions is very crucial and is very important and very significant as well.
Mr. Ambassador, while there are the files that concern peace and security and looking at it from a wider scope on how they could be reflecting their image and their position towards the West, we understand that. But don't you think that there still lacks some sort of agreements and approvals between the African countries in certain issues, especially when it comes to trade, for instance, lifting tariffs and the exports and imports businesses? I'm speaking about that in particularly of the COMESA summit that was witnessed last year in Sharm el-Sheikh. They signed numerous agreements, but there still seems to be a lot of struggle between African countries on in terms of their rights, each country's rights when it comes to tariffs and taxes and imports and exports. Unfortunately, there's this wide gap economically between African countries. While we see some very well developed, we see some very underdeveloped. How will this kind of problem ever be resolved between the African countries?
This is, of course, very true and a big problem. To have solid common African positions and enhanced interaction among African countries. You mentioned trade, it's very true. The inter-African trade is in the range of 11-12% compared to the European Union inter-trade, it is almost around 60%. Mm. So there is a huge gap, and we are lagging behind a lot, of course, in when we talk about our common African positions and our intra-African relations and intra-African interactions. This, of course, is a long way. It's a big challenge because it is a byproduct and it's an outcome of lots of factors. Some of it within and some from without as well.
When you speak of the factors, what are the most important factors? I mean, I'm sure we're not lacking resources and human forces, but we do lack understanding and becoming lenient towards each country's regulations and legitimate rights. Don't you think this is one of the main barriers?
These are part of the barriers as well, part of the barriers. We do have more robust political, should have more robust political will to overcome these barriers, to really achieve solid front in serving our peoples in the continent, to defend our interests as Africa vis-a-vis other interests at the global level. And of course, in this comes also responsibility of big powers as Egypt and other big countries in the continent to push hard toward this, and we did this. Mm. You mentioned the tripartite mm-hmm. summit which took place in Sharm el-Sheikh last June, and Egypt really was very instrumental in pushing towards this. And this is also linked to a wider context of the Pan-African Free Trade Area, which also are working hard to achieve it. But when we realize that this goal is not going to meet the target date in 2017, so Egypt was very much instrumental in pushing hard to convene this tripartite summit and to have this free trade agreement between the three big blocks, mm-hmm. trade blocks in the continent, in order to be a significant step forward toward achieving the Pan-African, the greater Pan-African free trade area. And this was very much appreciated continental-wise, continental level. And it was mentioned in so many occasions and events in the last African summit that this step is very important, and Egypt got appreciation for its effort in that field.
My final question to you also, Mr. Ambassador Mohammed Idris, we can't end this episode without speaking about until where has the Foreign Ministry of Egypt achieved in terms of negotiations over the Ethiopian Renaissance Dam, because this is a concern of every single Egyptian here, and maybe they might not be up to the awareness level of knowing exactly technically what is going on, but they do want assurances towards that, you know, the only free thing that they can have, the right to live in terms of uses of water, will not be touched, you know, in the upcoming years for them, for their children, for their grandchildren. So what efforts has the Foreign Ministry achieved so far in this file?
Of course, the concern of all Egyptians are so much legitimate and well understood, and of course everyone who knows Egypt knows well how this lifeline supply is crucial and vital to the existence and the life of all Egyptians. And this, of course, one or the basis on which any movement on the Egyptian side is anchored to. Mm-hmm. Of course, this issue has been aggravated over a long span of time. And always when you deal with issues at an early stage, the results are quicker and the cost is less. Mm-hmm. When you deal to it at a complicated stage, then it takes a longer time and it costs more. Mm-hmm. However, this issue, of course, is dealt with at the national level with the involvement of so many agencies and ministries, not only the foreign ministry, the foreign ministry, and so many other ministries and agencies involved in dealing with this issue with its two aspects, its technical aspect and its political aspect. We are moving forward on clear basis that what you mentioned and what everyone knows, that this lifeline is the lifeline of 90 million Egyptians, and we cannot compromise on this. Mm-hmm. The other thing, that when we pursue our activities and when we engage on this, we do not only look to our interest alone, but we also understand that we are member of a wider family and that we have to be cognizant and caring about our interests and also about the interests of our partners. And this now is the way forward. How do I see it? That the only way forward is to find and to get this balance, win-win, which would serve the interest and provide benefit and prosperity for the three partners of this great River Nile. So the great River Nile should be an area of cooperation, integration, and prosperity, not an area of contention. And of course, in this journey, we understand well that the lifeline of to all Egyptians and to 90 million Egyptians, and everyone understand this. No one can tolerate that this could be tempered with or compromised. Mm-hmm. But in this, let me also refer that to serve our interests in this file and in similar files, we have to also to be farsighted. Mm-hmm. We should not deal with the issue when the crisis happens. We have to be forward-looking, forthcoming, prophylactic in approach, anticipating the issues and dealing with it much, much earlier in time. And this is a lesson for other issues to come. And also, we should not try to move or to push the car from within. We have to push it from outside. Because sometimes we're only focused on trying to deal with the water file from inside, de-link it from any other relations with the sister African countries. They link it from common interest and joint interest. They link it from trade, from economy, from industry, from culture, from people-to-people relations. So if we do this, it would be as if we are trying to push the wagon from inside, not from outside. And this is not, of course, the proper effective approach.
Absolutely. Mr. Ambassador Mohammed Idris, the Assistant Foreign Minister for the African Affairs, we thank you very much for being with us on this exclusive interview. Thank you for your fruitful information.
Thank you very much. It's my great pleasure and honor. And I appreciate this attempt to spread the word of Africa and to elevate the awareness about the importance and the cruciality and vitality of this great continent to the life of all Egyptians. And we are part of this continent, of its history, and we should also be part, effective part in shaping its future. Thank you very much. Thank you.
This brings us to the end of our episode of our weekly program In the Hot Seat. We hope you'd enjoyed it, and do stay tuned for more exclusive interviews coming up in our further episodes. And once again, I'd like to thank also very much our dear guest, Ambassador Mohammed Idris, the Assistant Foreign Minister for the African Affairs, for his very fruitful information.